shooting team from Prairie Central against the more physical team from Wesclin.
Presents some interesting matchups, and Prairie Central is going to have to control the boards a little bit because Wesclin is an excellent rebounding basketball team, and both of them have some good offensive weapons. So it looks like a great championship game to me, Frank.
If Prairie Central has a weakness to exploit, it might be that their depth is suspect because their depth hasn't had a lot of experience. They got a lift from Justin Cox off the bench today by hitting six consecutive free throws with Dayton Cooperschmidt fouled out, Auberly fouled out, but Charlie Strasburger knows he's not very deep.
That's true, and Coach Lusk plays a couple of people off the bench, and it's going to be a great game, and we can't wait to get it started.
Looked at it as our last chance to do something and do something special. What that something was, we didn't really know.
Forward a 6'2" senior, number 44, Matt Fridley.
We had the pressure, and I think we all knew in the heart of hearts that this was it. I mean, this was our last go around.
At center, a 6'2" senior, number 42, Matt Brandmeier.
We had been hearing, you know, that we were a winning team for many years. And we, yeah, certainly part of that was, it was our year to win state.
The guards, a 5'8" senior, number 30, Mike Brink.
I think the mentality was at that time that this team couldn't get over the hump or this team couldn't win the big one. And, you know, when you're seniors and you're hearing stuff like that and you know it's your last time, yeah, I think there was a lot of pressure.
And the other guard is a 6'4" senior, number 50.
We did have a lot returning. That group had been together for a very long time, all of the seniors, and then we had some underclassmen contribute. So there's no doubt that we were looking to make a big run.
The 80s were an exciting time for Southern Illinois high school basketball. Coach Paul Lusk and his Warriors had won 7 regional championships, but had trouble getting out of the sectional round with nearby Lebanon usually in their way. In 87, Oakville had won the state title. The following year, Pinckneyville lost to Pena in the finals, and in 1989, conference rival Carlisle took home the trophy.
It was a compliment to our area, to our conference, to our county that Carlisle won the state title. They were a terrific team. We always had great battles with those guys. And then I think it does kind of help you to see someone from your area be able to make that big of a run.
So I think if anything, them winning, you know, would show us that we're ready to play with those teams, you know, and because we competed pretty well with them each year.
Myself, Paulie, and Mike Brink, we drove up to the Champaign and watched the state championship, watched them play. We got a hotel room, we stayed up there. And on our drive up, we're driving and the Carlisle fans are passing. And, you know, some of them recognized us in the car and they jotted some stuff on a piece of paper and held up next to the window of their car, and it said Carlisle in 89, and Wesclin in 90.
But just to be able to support them once they got there, and then for that motivation for us, that it was possible, although we really never even talked about it, it was there, it was in the back of our minds. And then for Clinton County to have back-to-back state championships was just a very special thing.
I think that, you know, someone local winning the tournament makes you believe that you can do it too.
We can do this. We're a small school, just like Carlisle. We can go up there and do something.
We played them tough our junior year, when the year that they won it, and we knew that, you know, with another year's experience, that, you know, we could also win state.
We had our hearts set on going to state the next year.
Everybody kind of knew the expectations of the team. But once the season started, you know, we kind of, you have to block that out. And for the most part, we did. You know, we had the, you always had the papers and the public talking about it, but yet we went at it with the aspect that, hey, we know what kind of players we have, what kind of team we have, and what we can do as a team if we stick together and go at it every night as hard as we can.
You know, we'd won regionals. Wesclin had won regionals, but they'd never won a sectional. And the idea of being a state champion, or that wasn't at the forefront of our mind. What we wanted to do was we wanted to get out of a sectional. You know, back then there were a lot of good teams, you know, that you had to go through. Lebanon, you know, was very, very good at the time, and we knew that they would be in our sectional, and so... That
was the scary thing. Would we be able to beat Lebanon? Because we knew if we could, then we could get where we wanted to go.
We had a chance, but a lot of things had to work out.
There was a lot of good teams back then, but it seemed like after Carlisle won state the year before, that was always kind of the team that had been in their path, and it seemed like finally it was their time to shine.
You know, hype comes from newspaper reporters and fans, and they don't always understand what it takes. You know, they assume that you've got the best talent in the world and you should win. And that year we had a lot of talent, and there's no doubt about it. You don't win without talent, so the expectations were great.
Yes, expectations were great, but first comes practice.
You know, practices were very difficult. Under Coach Lusk, they were pretty tough.
You had to stay on them. You had to chew butt. You had to be demanding. But that's part of it. I mean, you know, you just don't walk out there on the floor and say, you throw the ball out there and expect them to give you 110% and do things the way you want it done.
Our practices were just, I would say, probably the toughest in the area. I mean, the kids, they worked. They got no breaks. They worked, they worked, they worked. And at the end of the practice, when we were done with practice, they ran, they ran, they ran. And so, and we often got a kick out of that because, you know, the kids thought they'd be done. And all of a sudden, oh, no, no. And you'd see them all just hang their heads, and then they'd have to run some more, you know.
We didn't look forward to it, and I can tell you that. And that first 2 weeks or month of practice was all conditioning.
All I have to say is thank goodness we were 30-3. Thank goodness we won a heck of a lot more games than we lost, because it was always tough.
He made practice harder than the games.
And basically you ran some drills and then you ran for, you know, about 2 hours.
And you would go all the way around the perimeter of the basketball court on the line and up and around the basketball key, squatted down with your hands out in a defensive manner, and you're slowly walking, stepping from side to side. And I tell you what, the burn in the legs were unbelievable.
We would get so sore that we could barely move the next day at school. I mean, you could barely walk, and then you couldn't really, I mean, you couldn't lift your arms above your head if you had to.
But they weren't anything that we couldn't handle. I enjoyed them because they were challenging.
It was fun in a way because coach would say, all right, I want you to be, you know, Rennie Clemens tonight or Claggett. So he'd be, Rob, just shoot the ball here. He'd call me Ribs. He said, Ribs, just, I don't care if you hit the backboard, the rim, just throw it up there. I don't care. But, you know, he was tough on the starting five.
You know, so it got very physical. It got very difficult on both sides. And them guys, they tried to score. Obviously we had to stop them or else we got to run and they got to sit there and watch. So our practices were definitely harder than most of the games we got to play.
They were difficult, but fun. And I mean, I actually miss them.
The legendary part of the practices, I think, had to do more with Paul Senior and Paul Junior.
Yeah, we had a lot of wars, dinner wars.
Well, it was difficult at times, but I grew up in a coaching environment, and
having your dad as a coach can be a positive in a lot of ways, and then it can also be a negative in a lot of ways. But he was very demanding on me, as he was all the players. But in the end, it was a great experience.
There's always a few headbutts that go on. You talk to any coach that coaches his own son, or for that matter, probably a daughter. There are times when there's going to be a conflict.
Pretty tough to play for your dad, because he doesn't know anything.
And how they, well, I guess for lack of a better word, got along. You know, when we played, when all players played for Coach Lusk, he was an intimidating guy. Not when you got to know him, but his demeanor, his voice, there was a certain amount as a player of fear involved in how and your respect for him. Well, Paul Jr. didn't have that fear because he grew up with him. That was his dad. I mean, he wiped his nose and changed his diaper when he was a kid. So that element wasn't involved. So in practice, Paul Jr. didn't have the same attitude, I guess, sometimes as some of our other guys did. And it made for a very interesting dynamic when things didn't go well between them.
There's a lot of Coach Lusk stories. Some maybe we could share and some maybe we can't.
That I can share.
And you know, he always carried around this big moose cup full of Diet Coke.
You know, soda mugs getting thrown and things like that, but.
There's the one that sticks out in my mind the most.
I think the stories of, when he would get mad at Paulie and either kick him out of practice or Paulie would leave, I think those were the ones that stick out in my mind.
Paulie ended up walking home back to New Baden. It was cold and snow.
There would be times when I'd be walking home and then some local person who I would know would pull over and they would say, hey, there is no way we're picking you up, because if your dad finds out, he's going to chew us out. So there were a lot of great stories during that time.
Most I can't share, but the one I will share that has become real legend is on more than one occasion, Paul Jr. was kicked out of practice. Big Paul told him he needed to leave. He didn't go home and they needed to go home, and they weren't getting along. And I'll never forget one of the times that he kicked him out of practice, and they had a big green car, an old car. It was a Granada. And practice continued, and things were moving. And then all of a sudden we heard tires screeching and rocks throwing, and Paul Jr. had backed up the Granada, the car, as close as he could to the gym doors. And hit the gas and threw rocks all over the side of the gym and all over the doors. And as players, we didn't want to laugh because we didn't want to make things bad for us. But we bit our lips as hard as we could as he sped out of the parking lot upset.
When we'd scrimmage and practice, and he'd have a team, and Coach Lane would have a team, and he'd be singing Blueberry Hill and teasing Coach Lane because his side won. And
our JV team, if you would like to call it that, when you have Chad Dieters and Donnie Madwell and Ribs and Doug Felton and Clay Mackey and so on and so forth, you know, that team got to the championship of the sectionals the next year. So they were better than probably 3/4 of the high school varsity teams we played throughout the entire state championship run.
And so every once in a while you're scrimmaging and they're kind of going through motions, and in this particular practice, Paulie was going through the motions big time. He was kind of, lopping along out there, not really pushing himself a whole lot. Paul got on him once or twice, and then finally he got so mad, he made him take off his jersey and turn it around, and they were orange and we were usually black, or it was the other way around. I can't tell you at this point, but he made him turn his jersey around and he put him on JV. So... what was funny about that was, and one of our kids went over and played with the varsity. So he comes over and I got him in a huddle and I said, hey, let's take care of business here. And he says, probably shouldn't say this on air. He said, yeah, let's kick their ass. And we did. I mean, I don't know that they scored in about the next 10 minutes, but we scored every time down the floor, and he was the guy scoring. I mean, he was unstoppable. He was so mad and so focused, they couldn't stop him. And it was just funny. And then, you know, then his dad blows the whistle, and he says, yeah, that's what I want. That's what I want out of you, you know. And but that's tough, you know, for a kid to play like that every night of practice. It really is. And
Paulie getting, you know, poor guy, he got kicked out of practice. He got yelled at for, I don't know, we were playing Red Bud or something. He forgot his warm-up jerseys and couldn't play.
Where we went to Greenville, and I just remember after the game that Coach Lusk was so mad in the locker room that he would try to chew us out, and then he'd stop mid-sentence, and he'd be running back out of the locker room trying to run down the refs.
And I remember him chasing after the officials into their locker room area.
Pounding on the door where the officials had barricaded themselves in.
He crazy.
You look back at some of those stories, and some of them are, you know, they're just part of the dynamics of who we were, and we all understood it, you know.
Wesclin would start the season losing two of their first three games and one more at Christmas break.
It was a blessing in disguise to lose two, three games and get their minds right, realize that they just couldn't walk on the floor because of what people were saying about them and when. It took more than that.
They would not lose again and would finally win a sectional championship.
Once we turned the corner at Christmas, we started to play. We were playing well anyway, but we really started to play well.
From there we set out. We lost one game for the rest of the season.
When we won the sectional and we were able to go to that super sectional, that was just a thrill because there were 16 teams left in the state, and we knew we were right there. Very close to getting to Champaign, and then we were able to win that super sectional, and then you get the state tournament. And I can remember pulling up, and I had been to Assembly Hall, but most of the guys hadn't seen it, and they were just kind of in awe. And it's an experience, and it's a memory that you'll have the rest of your life.
On the first possession, Lusk, the team's leading scorer, would get his first foul. Wesclin and Prairie Central would trade baskets for most of the first half. With the Warriors heading into the locker room, leading by four.
Hawks with 4:54 to play. Inside, Lusk.
The second half would be just as exciting as the first, but with 2 minutes and 50 seconds left and Wesclin down by two, Lusk would fall out of the game.
Well, you know, I just thinking about it, I probably get a little bit emotional. I was really proud of my teammates. I know just sitting there when I fouled out, it was a tough time, but yet I also had faith in my teammates. And I think they just did an unbelievable job.
Well, you know, you're thinking about the team first, naturally. But then it was difficult to get through that without your kid out there. Biggest stage of his life up to that point. And he's not in the ball game. And you know, it was hard. But you got to try to win the game and forget about him. You know, it hurt as a parent, but you got to keep coaching.
I was scared because I was worried I was going to have to go in, and I hadn't played much in the game. I played just a couple minutes, and it's a joking thing, but I was nervous because he was going to call either me or Chad Dieters, and he called Chad, which obviously worked out great.
We get a score, and we got to find ways to score because he created so much for us, obviously, offensively.
You know, I mean, you can't say enough about the effort we gave without my boy in there. I mean, you can't say enough about how Brent played and Matt and Mike and Matt and just and whoever else played. Donnie played in the state tournament. Chad Dieters played in the state tournament. They were tough kids. They hung in there. They wanted it in the worst way, and it came out the right way as far as we're concerned.
Here's Friendly. Friendly whirls. He goes to the hoop and got it. He got it. We're tied. 71-71. 12 seconds left to play in the basketball game. Deadlocked at 71 apiece. Here's Gary Tidwell across. They'll play it for the final shot, of course. Tidwell whirls, the ball knocked away. Picked up with 1 second left. Friendly from behind the timeline over the backboard. We're in overtime in the assembly hall. Okay, there's your timeout situation. Murray Central brings it down quickly. 25 seconds left. Here's Elliott, lost the ball on the drive. Brady down. Missed the ball to Brink. Brink for the layup. Scores. We're tied. Mike Brink. 14 seconds, 76-76. Prairie Central Hawks on the attack. We're in the first overtime, tied at 76. There's Gazelle.
With less than a second left, Wesclin fouls.
Wesclin didn't foul him. Matt Fridley fouled him, right?
I fouled him. Unfortunately. So tired. And I gambled. He spun away. I wasn't expecting him to. I grabbed him. They called a foul. Well, coach obviously calls a timeout, which I was like, nah, it's not a good time because I really don't want to talk to him. So ran over to the bench. He asked me, did you foul him? Well, of course. No, I didn't foul him. It was a terrible call. Yeah, I you know, obviously the video's there. I definitely fouled him.
It was like, I just remember being, I mean, you're at the mercy of this kid now. There's nothing we can do. I mean, he hits this basket, it's game over. I just remember out of that timeout, one of our players walking by the kid at the free throw line, and I think they might have said something to the kid along, I don't know exactly what was whispered in his ear or yelled at him.
I'd like to know what was said.
Went back out there, I'll never forget it. You know, I literally was so scared, I couldn't even say nothing to Darren Bazell that was getting ready to shoot the free throw, and Brent's down there telling him, think about it, don't choke.
I think Brent walked by the kid that was shooting it and told him that he was going to choke it off.
I just recall putting my hands on my head and looking in the air and thinking, are you kidding? Like, this is how, you know, it's gonna end. Because the kid that was going to the line, he was a good player. And earlier in the day, and I knew this earlier in the day, he'd hit a last-second shot that put them in the state championship. And I really thought that that was it.
When I thought we had lost the game right there at the end, and I told Steve Lane, my assistant, read, well, I don't know if I really care because they couldn't have given a better effort. And I said that on the bench. Well, we didn't finish second, so everything turned out great. And
it was scary because you just assume he's going to make the free throw. So I remember, just sitting there biting on a towel or chewing on your fingers and just hoping he'd miss. I've seen a picture of our bench while he's shooting that. I don't know if you've seen that, but it's kind of neat. We're all just sitting there. Everybody's obviously watching and in a very tense moment. And I remember it just coming off the front of the rim, and luckily we got to go to overtime.
After all this, this is how, it's going to end. But thank God it didn't end that way.
It's tough. Free throws can win or lose games. And in that situation, you have to get breaks when you're trying to win a state title or you're trying to make a big run like that. And we had a very good team, but obviously if that free throw goes in, it's over and none of this happens. He missed it.
And he short-armed it. Wasn't even a close. Thank God for me. We got to go in the next overtime and got an opportunity to win it.
The rest, they say, is history.
It's out of all of the memories and just winning a state championship, I think the thing that you think about, it's the relationships and your teammates and the bond that you have with the coaches.
I know I can call Brent or Paulie or Fish or whoever and Pat Hempen and, hey, I need something and it would be done. And it'd be vice versa. It's just that bond that we have is never going to be broken.
More than anything, it was the hard work that, he asked us to, he asked to see, every day and every game and just leave everything out on the floor.
Impossible. I could list 50. I don't know if it's a memory or not, but the thing that is most important to me is the way that we built relationships. And those guys are then and now. We have such a bond that we have and a connection. And some of our players, my ex-teammates, I talk to a lot, and some I don't. But even in those guys that we don't communicate all the time, when we do, it's just it's an immediate bond, and it's just an immediate love and affection for each other because of what we experienced. And the banner, the everything in the gym, the state championship is neat, but the idea that you take away lifelong relationships with your coaches and players that you played with, to me, is the best memory and the most valuable thing of the experience.
We were all friends. We weren't just a team, on the court. We all hung out together off the court. That includes Pat Hempen and Donnie and Chad and all the underclassmen. We all stuck together. We all were together at all times. So we spent many a nights, talking and about what we need to do, how we need to do some things. So we self-corrected ourselves more than most.
With Brent and Paul and Hush, Fish and Matt as the starting team, those guys showed a lot of leadership in a lot of different aspects. Everybody had their role, and there was no worrying about what's my role versus what's your role. If you were coming up off the bench to go help that team, you had a specific role, and it was just as important as anybody else's role.
They always built each other up. They knew what was at stake. They fired each other up constantly. I mean, they fed on each other. I mean, if it wasn't Brent or Paul, I mean, you know, one of the two, Matt or Mike, would always pick us up.
All of the former players that played for him were always around.
Well, those guys were my idols. Jeff DeMond, Robbie Wetzler, Doug Miller, the Ritzheimers. It's just, I could go on and on. Those guys were important role models for me, for the rest of us. Brent, you know, Brent and I would go to the games. We looked up to those guys, and we cherished the day that we would get to high school and be able to be a Wesclin basketball player.
Well, you know, I always said this, and I know the kids didn't believe me. I was just as proud of some of my teams that went, won 18, 19, 20 games or whatever the amount might be. I was never really disappointed from the effort standpoint and the attitudes of the kids. But again, when I look back on some of those teams I had and some of the kids and how hard they played, they overachieved. I think most of our teams overachieved, and you can't ask for any more than that.
That's a good question, and well, as you can see, I'm having a hard time getting it out because, give me a minute.
I think he drove me. I think that helped me in life. It's helped me as a coach. I've been around coaching my whole entire life. I've been around basketball. I think kids are different these days, though. I think as a whole, it's tougher to just totally be that demanding on them. You have to pat them on the butt. You have to pick them up. But it was a great experience for me. I wouldn't change anything. It made me a better player. It made me a better person, and I think it's made me a better coach.
Okay. Coach Lusk taught us the value of hard work and sacrifice. There's no question. Nothing in life comes easy, and it always takes a certain amount of effort and sacrifice to achieve anything worthwhile. And he was very instrumental in, I guess, a lot of success I had in my life.
A high level of respect for Coach Lusk. In a lot of aspects, he taught us a lot about manhood, about being tough, and about being strong, about not giving up, about working together. He only expected perfection from us.
He instilled in us just a desire to win. And, you know, I mean, he wanted to win, no doubt about it, but we had to want to win too. And in order to do that, you know, we had to be competitive.
He made you play hard. He made you be responsible. He didn't like you getting caught up in, you know, you see these kids these days get caught up in playing the game and having a little swagger to themselves. And I mean, he didn't go for all that. He wanted you to go out, play the game, play it hard, play it right. And it just kind of makes you, you know, look back, you know, 25 years later, I look back and you go to some of these games and you see what goes on the floor and you just shake your head because Coach Lusk would never allow what goes on these days.
He's had a huge impact as far as how I coach and how I approach, you know, relationships and with my players and with how we play the game.
You know, it's interesting that all the little things that he taught us, non-basketball, are the big things that you remember now that you're older and you get it. We were very defined in what we're going to do on the team, our roles. And, you know, Paulie's role, you know, score, rebound, Brent, score, rebound. Mine was to defend and rebound and hit the open shot when, and Mike Brink, you know, take care of the ball and make sure you don't have any turnovers. Matt Brandmeier, defend. Well, those little things there prepare you, obviously, for life, because in life now you have a role, you have responsibilities and you accountability. All those things that he did, because we spent a lot of time at his house, you know, as well, with Paulie. So, you know, yeah, you owe a lot to him, because he actually turned a lot of boys into men, if you will, that year.
And everything that he did had a purpose. And a lot of that had to do with how we played together as a team, how we stood together as a team, how we interacted together with the team, how we communicated on and off the court. We were a family. And that's one of the biggest things I think he instilled in us.
You know, one of the things I do remember was one of the guys, we were somewhere in Belleville, and some person that wasn't even associated with our fans came up and noticed us and said something negative about Coach. And he had, I think there was five of us, he had all five of us about to beat this guy to a pulp. And I think he was trying to be funny, but it that kind of drove it home as well, that, you know, we might not agree all the time together, but nobody from the outside is going to point out any fault. So, and I still think that would hold true today.
I think that's what Wesclin had. I don't think it was ever really about one specific team, because you can always have a good team, but can you have a good program? And I think when my dad was there as the coach, they had a good program. And then ultimately we were able to cap that off with the big run and the state title.
I can't take much credit for those kids. You look at their parents, they raised them. I'll take a little bit maybe, but not much. I pushed them and demanded a lot, but they had it in them for the most part, those kids.
And the unique thing about our parents, and this goes for not only my mom and dad, but all the parents, they didn't question the role. They knew the role that we were assigned. They knew if we stayed there, we'd be fine. They could have been like every normal parent and said, no, you need to shoot more. You need to do this, or you need to. We had none of that. You know, they knew our role. They knew it was defined. They didn't worry about future things and getting your name in a paper. They supported our roles and responsibilities. So it was definitely we got raised by the tribe of parents and coaches and our fans. And so it was, but the impact on him, yeah, absolutely. But it goes much, much, much further than that.
But the community, how they supported us throughout, there was signs everywhere. I mean, every person had a sign in their yard. Out in the country, you'd drive by and the farmers would have these huge signs out. We had people with orange cars, and it was just a full community effort, and that was probably one of the coolest memories for me as well.
That community, that school, all of the people that were involved, from the fans, the coaches, the parents, the players, the managers, the cheerleaders, everyone across the board, they should be very proud of. And I know the people that were a part of that, they look back on that, and it'll be a great memory for them.
Injured player, a member of the team, Rob Blinn. Number 10, Jeff Brokering. Number 12, Pat Hempen. Number 24, Clay Mackey. Number 52, Doug Feld. Number 32, Rob Wegman. Number 22, Chad Deiters. Number 34, Don Maddenwald. number 42, Matt Brandmeier. Number 30, Mike Brink. Number 44, Matt Fridley. Number 40, Brent Brady. And number 50, Paul Lusk. Those are the state champions, the Warriors of Wesclin High School.
Hush was just, I think he made it, he swished a shot and he said, hush.
We were right over there at St. George. And Paul and I were shooting around and we said, come on up, we're going to shoot baskets. And he came up and we were out shooting and he still had a southern accent. And he shot one and made it and he went, hoosh. And we said, what? You know, hoosh, when it goes in the basket, hoosh. So from then on, we called him hoosh. And then it kind of changed to hush, and that's it. I haven't called him anything but hush.
Boy, you don't have to edit anything out. Hell no. Edit? I'm being nice. I didn't even mention parents. Their kid is the best. You know, their school is the best, and I've seen it. I coached many years, and I saw it in other schools with other coaches, and you talk to them, and come on, people aren't realistic. I think you could probably say and demand more back then. Today it's, you know, it's so politically correct and everything has to be so proper and it makes you almost want to throw up. Well, like all stories, you know, and some of them are probably true, but then, you know, they tend to be exaggerated as each year passes, and so you don't know what to believe when they start talking. If you win something like that, you're great. If not, you're a piece of shit. You didn't get the job done. Now, don't get me wrong. That's all fine and good. But it does. You can cut this out. I'm such an I don't care. I don't care what they think. Never have, never will. And you say, oh, come on, you care. Nah, not really. Is that camera still on?
We can turn it off.
No. And when I got my head job, I said, no, it's just not going to be that way. If you want to say hi as a parent, fine. We don't need to establish any type of relationship to any extent because you get burnt. And my boy is this and my boy is that. No, get out. I don't. Today, I don't know if you can do that. I think you have to actually listen to those insane parents out there. And that's a shame. Mr. So-and-so says that, you know, you're treating Johnny differently and you said this and you said that. Oh, boy. Love and respect your parents. Just don't bring their basketball knowledge and or lack of. You know, like I always said, hey, I'd like to get some of those parents in there and organize a practice, you know, and put them in there for a week or put them in the classroom for a week. Huh? Good luck. I always said this, you know, I never would tell a farmer how to do his job or a mechanic or, you know, and on a carpenter. Don't you tell me how to do mine.